That was the Gargars and Hypnotised. And with us now is Gavin Tate from the Gargars. Hello, Gavin.
Hi, Nick.
How you doing?
Yeah, brilliant.
Good. What's that? Where was that song from? You sent me some songs ages ago. Was that on the single?
That was on the EP, on our Repulsion 7-9 EP. And we recorded it in April.
Okay.
So I think I sent it to you roughly after that.
You did, yeah. And that was really kind of different to the stuff. When were the first demos you sent out?
The first demos were like early 2009, and we recorded them at Transmission Studios in Brighton.
Yeah.
With a guy called Alistair. And I think we've come a long way since then.
It kind of sounds like it, yeah. What was the sort of, was it the different recording atmosphere, and did you have a producer on board or something for the new stuff?
I think we planned to work with a guy called James Aparizio, and he had a really good reputation. So he'd worked with people like Nick Cave and Mogwai and Depeche Mode. And I think we needed to work with someone who could bring out our style a bit more.
Yeah.
I think that always helps.
I suppose so, yeah, yeah. And how's it been going?
Really well, yeah. We're gigging constantly. We're playing in Europe a lot now.
I saw that. Is it Lithuania you went to?
Yeah, we played a festival in a town called Vilnius in Lithuania. Okay. It's called Drop Dead Festival, and we travelled about 48 hours on a coach to get there, and we didn't know what to expect, you know, if anyone was going to be there to watch us. And we played to about 1,000 people, and everyone went mad, and we sold all our merchandise afterwards, and it's just a really good response.
Yeah.
So it's really good to be doing stuff internationally now.
And how are you getting those kind of gigs? I mean, have you got sort of management and booking?
Yeah,
and stuff
we've
like
got
that?
A booking agent now, and we've got a label, and people are really pushing us. And they're doing all the press and stuff. Whereas a lot of the time before, it was a bit DIY. So
we're
having to do everything ourselves, which is quite hard work when we can only really fund ourselves to record and rehearse and play. And it's a hard business, but you do need some people helping you out on the way.
Yeah.
I think with our label, I think they're trying to, I think they see us as quite marketable now.
Yeah.
We've got an image and we look like a band. And I think sometimes that is important. And not always. I mean, you've got amazing bands like the Pixies, and they just look like, you know, regular people.
Sure
and
thing.
So
UPS drivers or something.
Yeah, and it's like, I don't know, I used to see bands like the 80s Matchbox Beeline Disaster just walking around Brighton when I first moved here. I used to be like, they look amazing, you know.
Sure thing, yeah. I think, you know, you need to have that kind of package, really. I mean, you know, no one knows what the Arcade Fire look like, for instance, but it really helps if you've got that whole kind of package thing going on.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the label, is it Playground?
Yeah, the Playground Records.
How is that structured then? I mean, is that a single deal, or have you got an album thing coming up with them?
We signed a contract to do, it's sort of short hold, so we can release with them until we find something bigger, if possible. And I mean, they're more of a PR company, but they run some of the biggest nights in London. Like, they run nights at the Scala and the Coco in Camden. Yeah. And they just had an idea for a label, and they asked us if we wanted to be the first band on it.
Okay.
And we thought it was a really good way of getting, you know, a bit more exposure and getting our name out.
Sure thing. And they help out with promotion and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, they're doing all the press. They're sending everything out, and It's been a good process for them so far.
I just handed Nick a note saying I want to ask about the name.
All right.
Ask about the name.
Okay, Liz.
How did you choose your name?
The name came about, I was, because I'm from Jersey originally. I used to be a bit mad when I was young, so I got the nickname Gavin Gaga.
Okay.
And I started the band around 2003, and I was sort of wanting a name for the band, so that was the best, you know, that was the best thing to come along.
Yeah.
I recently found out there's a band called Gar, and they're like a German prog band from the 70s.
Oh, and, they're not so bad.
I'm not aware of them.
Be in their footsteps. Yeah.
Have you heard of them?
No, I like a lot of that stuff, though.
Yeah.
But I was thinking it's quite handy with Lady Gaga.
No.
But it's interesting that, in fact, you know, this comes from a genuine attachment you have to that name. But then it is useful when there's someone really high profile with that name, but then you've got it for a genuine reason. But you can get a bit of the
I think you've got two extra A's, haven't you?
Yeah, I reckon we've got two extra A's, but I reckon she definitely stole it from us.
Yeah, of course. She heard your story.
Yeah.
Well, now, Gavin's suggested some tracks to play. And what kind of made me interested about this, when I said that, I thought it would be kind of things like, Vampire Weekend and the horrors and that, very kind of new and current things.
Yeah,
right. And you haven't really gone that way, have you? I mean, yeah. The first track we're going to play in a sec is Jump In At The Fire by Harry Nilsson. Yeah. Where did you find that?
My dad's introduced it to me. He's into a lot of that style of music. So he bought me that album, Nilsson Smilsson, when I was a kid. And I just fell in love with that track because it's got a really good edge to it.
It's an awesome song. I mean, I know bits and bobs of what he's done. I don't have that album, but that song, Jump Into the Fire, is in Goodfellas. That's where I first saw that. I just thought, what the hell is this? And to find out that it was by the same guy who did the Midnight Cowboy thing.
Yeah.
Bonkers.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it?
Let's play that.
We can make each other happy. this is David Essex. Life is pretty much what you make it. Life can be a really beautiful experience all on its own. I know sometimes people forget this and try and find some kind of answer by using hard drugs. What usually happens is that life isn't beautiful anymore. So take my advice and get into life and not hard drugs.
Rocko! Rocko!
As The Rapture and House of Jealous Lovers from, I think, when was it? When did you say that?
It was about 2002.
2002. Yeah, I'd mentioned to James at Source that, you know, The Rapture was one of these things, and I kind of found it and downloaded it and put it on, and I liked it. And he said, yeah, that whole album is a game changer.
Yeah.
I've kind of been aware of them for a little while, probably without ever hearing a note, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's good. All good.
Yeah, they never fail, The Rapture. They're still releasing great records now.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you were saying that was kind of a sort of turning point in punk dance sort of things.
I mean, there was lots of bands like the AAAs and stuff coming out around that time. And I think The Rapture had more of a groove, you know. They appealed to clubbers as well. So it's, you know, indie kids like them. And then people who'd go, you know, into rave music
would
be dancing to The Rapture, which is...
I mean, the AAAs more recently sound like that. Whereas they kind of didn't before, you know.
They were a bit more
Gold Lion and that from the first couple of albums were not like that particularly at all. But something like Zero, that could be.
Yeah, they've done the sort of dance crossover, which is it's great. It's the AAAs had sort of a good sort of run, and Yeah, and the great thing is both of those bands are still going now, and you know, and there is a lot of sort of bands from that time that are still making great records.
Yeah. So, how long have you been in band?
Since I was about 17, so 2001.
Okay. And what other bands have you been in?
I was in a band called The Valentines. They're based in Brighton.
I'm aware of them. I didn't know you were in them.
Yeah, I was the original guitarist.
Oh, okay.
But we're a bit more sort of Cure-esque when I was
right.
There. So
okay.
We were sort of a bit more darker, and the singer Christian Cheger he's one of my best friends.
Okay.
He wanted to make a pop band,
right?
And obviously I was into a bit more sort of darker stuff, yeah. So it didn't really work as well. So he got new people in, and yeah,
seems to be working out all right for him.
Yeah, they're doing really good. Yeah. They supported the Libertines about 3 or 4 weeks ago.
I believe so.
Yeah.
And who else?
I was in a band called Mascara Masquerade, which is like a joke disco band.
Okay.
I was in another band in Brighton called Necrolcelia with Oliver Spleen.
Yeah, yeah.
Which was, yeah, quite short and brief. It was good, though.
Okay. And so when you were a kid with a tennis racket in front of the mirror and all of that kind of stuff, who were you being when you sort of thought, I want to really do this for real? And
I really sort of admired Robert Smith from The Cure.
Yeah.
That was sort of my hero, so I sort of grew up trying to look like him, you know, doing the whole,
of course,
you know, back comb in the hair, and like, yeah. And I just sort of, I don't know, I wanted to be like I wanted to be a pop star, you know. I didn't want to be like an architect or,
no,
you
sure.
know. And that's sort of why, yeah, the reason why I'm still doing music now and doing what I'm doing.
So, what are you, 26 or something?
26. Yeah.
And so when you were in that kind of formative time, what, sort of 14, 15, what was the kind of current things that were going on? Because I think about when I was that age, and it was bands like The Cure, but it was obviously sort of some 15 years before that.
Yeah,
you know, was it bands like The Rapture and stuff like that were going on that made you think, this is for me?
At the time, I was sort of, when I was about 14, 15, I was into like Britpop, so I was listening to bands like Blur and
okay.
and Pulp and stuff like that. So it was a bit later on when I sort of, you know, I started seeing bands like the 80s Matchbox Beatles,
yeah, yeah.
Disaster, sort of, you know, pulling through, and that sort of inspired me, and I wanted to make a bit, you know, sort of darker experimental music,
yeah.
You know, like rather than pop, you know, like sort of British pop music.
Yeah.
So, but I think you can still hear a bit of Britpop in what we do,
okay.
in areas, but yeah, I wanted to make something a bit more sort of fast and dancey.
Mm.
Which is, you can see in some of the direction from some of our songs, like Hypnotized.
Yeah,
there is a dance element.
Yeah, very much so, yeah.
And you know, that that was the way we were wanting to go.
Mm. And how far do you think you know, a band in that kind of area can sort of take it now?
You can take it as far as you want to take it. I mean, a lot of bands nowadays are quite short-lived,
yeah.
which is a shame, because there has been some really great bands, especially come out of Brighton, and like bands like Maths Class, they were really great, and you know, technically amazing.
Died, didn't they?
Yeah, I think what it was is their style of music was sort of you know, made a bit more popular by bands like Foals, who
yeah.
really pushed through, and it sort of left them in the dark, which is a shame, because they're a really amazing band.
Yeah.
And it's such a great name. I missed them altogether, but I'd love to have seen the Maths Class.
I never saw them, but they were pretty good.
Yeah,
great,
wouldn't
what
it?
I remember.
Go to your friends. I'm going to the Maths Class. I'm going to
Maths Class. Yeah, yeah. No, they were a great band, and it's a shame that, you know, that so many sort of good bands from Brighton sort of split up.